Welcome to Don't Get Rusty, where we have fun chatting about things that will help keep you proficient. I'm Keith West, and today our webinar is The Shocking Things You May Not Know About Your Electrical System. We're going to jump right into introductions, but if you will give me 60 seconds, I will tell you how you can interact with the panelists here on the webinar. And so if you see, if you're using a computer, this is what your screen should look like. If you're only seeing the little tabs on the left, that means that you are minimized. And if you want to expand it, you can hit the little white arrow in the orange to see the connections you may have for microphone and your speakers. And you are muted at this point. And so that means that you don't have to worry, but you can talk and we're not going to hear you. And that's fine because you are muted.
You can't hear me? And then
if you look at me? Yeah, I can hear you. Can you hear me? Yeah. All right, Pablo. All right. So if you look at the little triangles there, you can see the audio. And so you can pick what audio setting you want. And then if you want to ask a question, you will be interacting with our producer, Steven, who is on the call but not on camera. Steven, say hi.
Hello, everyone.
Steven will be happy to interact with you. All right. And then if you are using a cell phone or a tablet, your display should look something like this. And if you see the microphone and you are muted. And if you want, there's a little gear for audio changes if you want to change your audio setup. And if you want to ask a question, now that is the main thing, that way that you will be able to interact with us. You send Steven and Pablo a question and they will take a look at it. And hopefully we will get a lot of them answered on the air. But if not, you know, we will try to answer in the question section at the end, plus send you emails. And so we welcome questions and interactions and any comments that you might have. And if you can see the little people icon there with the little number, that means that you have a message. Okay, so introductions. I am Keith West, as I said, and my title is Senior Director for Flight School Business Support. At AOPA here, I would work with flight schools to help them be able to deliver a better experience for our students and to be more successful commercially. And I am joined by my colleague who will be in the lead today, Chris Mosier. Chris, introduce yourself.
Hey, it's Chris Mosier. I'm the Senior Director for Flight Training Education at AOPA. And so I work with, again, just like Keith, flight schools and CFIs, and I kind of do education stuff, oddly enough. Hey, Pablo, we got Pablo here too. Tell us about yourself.
Thanks, Chris. I'll take it from here. So my name is Pablo Morelia, Senior Director of Flight Training Technology. So I work with these guys, including Jamie. You see, that's a new guy here. And I do a lot of technology stuff. So mostly that's meant creating a new app for us, for CFIs to use in cockpit to train pilots and hopefully turn around the decline in student pilots. So if anyone wants to know more about that, I'll let you know, and maybe we'll do something later. So that's just my little promotion. Jamie.
Hey, I'm Jamie Beckett. I'm AOPA's ambassador for the You Can Fly program. I'm based in Florida, and I basically do what Pablo was talking about, turning around those numbers. So I help people start flying clubs. I work with flight schools. I work with high school programs. Basically, I'm the resource. Whatever your problem is, I find a solution to it to get you into flying and keep you in flying.
And of course, not only is Jamie, though, a CFI, but he's an AMP, which is why he's here with us today.
All right. Well, awesome. Well, I am going to, if I can find my mouse, there it goes. It's jumping from one screen to another. I am going to give the presentation over to Chris, who is going to be the leader. And we're going to talk about electrical systems. Now, Chris, are we going to be able to make electrical systems interesting?
I think so, because that's what we do here. I think it'll get me all charged up. I'm just saying.
Okay. So you are live, Chris. It's over to you. You got it, buddy.
All right. So thanks, everybody. So what we're going to do today is, why should we know our electrical system? And so it's I'm hoping we can make this interesting. We're gonna take a little deeper dive into how some of it works and really talk about why we want to know this in the sense of operating the aircraft efficiently, but most importantly, safely. And so that really comes down to, you know, do we know what to do and what's going on when things go awry? So today's outline, we're going to cover three basic things. We're going to talk a little bit about how it works, maybe in some more detail than you've done before, or for a lot of folks, it might be a review. We're going to talk a good bit about what happens when it breaks and what you should do. And then the final part is, how do we take all this stuff today and put it into practical application to help us be better pilots? And the cool thing is we've got Jamie on board here today too, who's an AMP, because he knows way more about this stuff than I do. So he'll be adding in lots of great knowledge. Right, Jamie?
Oh, that's a guarantee. Absolutely, Chris.
You hear that, Jamie? The pressure's on you, because, you know, we're just CFIs and pilots, you know? We don't know anything about all this mechanical stuff.
Exactly. So we just rolled our first poll here, and the question is, how confident are you in your electrical systems knowledge? So I'll be curious to see what everybody says on this one. We got the idea of, like, can you wire it yourself, you know, blindfolded? Or I just know what switches to click? Or maybe some folks just, like, I dumped all of that after my check ride.
Yeah, I hear that, right?
Anybody here in our group, like, just is on the more of the level of, I know where the fuel selector is?
I should probably point out, I used to own a 1940 J3 Cub that didn't have an electrical system. That was right. The easiest one I ever had the schematic for, just a blank sheet.
Would you recommend that as the airplane for people that don't want to learn about electrical systems?
I think that's mandatory, frankly.
Oh, look here. We got some confident people here. That's wow. Right.
What are the results looking like?
Well, you know, it's kind of overwhelmingly. It seems like people kind of know what they're doing, you know. So I don't know why they're listening to us if they know what they're doing.
Yeah.
But, 80% all right, Stephen, let's roll that poll. Let's put it out there. Let's see the results. Look at you people.
That's
awesome.
Good.
That's well, awesome.
Yeah. I like that.
What I like here is, it's like, we know what switches to do. So we definitely, and I'm glad, isn't it kind of cool that people do know what switches to click? But maybe the idea of, like, I could hand wire it myself. So there's a little bit there we could go a little deeper dive and maybe learn some new stuff.
Well, you know, I got to tell you that I didn't know what even all the switches were until I became a flight instructor and had a lot of time to sit over there and look, you know.
This is true. Right? Well, especially the environmental system, right? We always talk about the heat, the cabin heat, when I finally use that.
Totally. All right, Stephen, let's take those results down. Well, boys, we're going to have to up our game, because this is an educated, sophisticated audience. Can we do it?
I think so, but we'll keep it simple at the same time.
You got it.
All right. So what we're going to do is, just starting out with the basics. I'm starting out really basic right here, is just the, and we'll go kind of quickly through this, but just your real basic electrical system, you know, at the most simple. I mean, maybe, I don't know if a Cub would operate like this. I know a glider could do this. But you have your basic system with the battery, and then a switch, the master switch that turns the battery on, and then whatever you're running off of it, the landing light, whatever it might be. And so we know that would be your absolute most basic system. And of course, if we just ran things that way, we're going to be limited in what we do, because eventually that battery is going to run down. But one thing, Jamie, I wanted to ask you about was this idea of, why is it important to know what the battery does, in the sense of some are 12 volts, some are 24 volt. Why would we care about that?
Well, any kind of accessories you buy, even a plug-in to charge an iPad, something like that, you've got to know if that's a 12 or 24 volt peripheral. So if you plug a 12 volt peripheral into a 24 volt system, it won't last very long. It's just too much voltage. It's going to short things out and burn.
I have a question. Yeah. Can I ask a question? Okay, so, you know, it says 12 and 24 volts, but, you know, I see references to, like, 14 and 28 volts, and so I'm confused about why you have these different, you know, voltages. Are there only two? Are there four? What's the deal?
It's a rounding thing, Keith. A 12-volt battery isn't really 12 volts. It's 12.6 volts, because each cell is 2.1 volts, and there's six cells. 24-volt battery, same thing. It's upped a bit. So in order to charge that battery, if we just ran it at 12.6 volts, it would slowly deplete itself. We need an extra volt or two to go recharge that battery while your system is running. So that's why it is a 12 volt or a 24 volt battery, but the system operates at 14 or 28.
I've learned something already. Thank you.
No, that's good. That's awesome.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, thanks everybody for coming.
I'll take the win, and I'm retired now.
Shortest webinar ever. All right. So what we're going to do is let's go in a little bit beyond that. So obviously in a system like this, if we were just running on a battery, eventually it's going to die. And so of course we know that that's not the optimal way to do it. We want to have some way to recharge it, which brings us to things that'll charge it, generators and alternators. And so what I kind of wanted to do here is Jamie already mentioned the idea of having that 28 volt or 24 volt sort of generator alternator system is to recharge the battery. Let's talk a little bit about how those work. And so in this case, we'll start with kind of the original in the sense of charging, which is an old school generator, which maybe some of you folks have flown on older airplanes. I can't say that I've ever flown with a generator myself, but if you have flown with an airplane with a generator, you'll know that when you change the RPM, for example, pull it to idle, your landing light could dim. And in fact, there's a good discussion of this in one of the articles in the handout that we've got. So check that out on the resources later. But for the generator, let's just take a quick look at how that works. You'll notice here on the screen, we've got this wire coil with our electrical system. You'll see the master switch kind of down there. And then in the generator, we've got this magnet. And it was my poor attempt of drawing that little supposedly round arrow showing that if you take the magnet and spin it or move it around the coil of wire, the magnetic field actually starts moving electrons, and that's what generates electricity. So if you can imagine, the faster I move that magnet, the more electricity I create. Of course, the one challenge here being that when you do that, the faster you move it, the more electricity, it's going to change the amount of, what's the proper term here, the amperage or voltage that would be?
Voltage, Jamie? It's inducing a voltage, and that voltage is going to change.
So it would be more voltage the faster you go. So when you change in the RPM on an airplane, because these generators and even the alternators, as we know, are directly connected to the engine, that's going to change how much is coming out. So what we use is something called a voltage regulator to help kind of even it out, to keep it within the limits we want for our electrical system.
Well, I'm a little bit confused. So I'm asking Jamie, okay, over there. So Jamie, what's the difference between voltage and amperage?
That's a really good question, actually. Voltage is the component of electricity that causes the electricity to move. Think of it that way. Think of it as a hose coming out of a tower. So voltage is how tall that tower is, how much force that water comes out with. Amperage is how wide that hose is. It actually does the work. But the downhill part, that force is what causes it to happen. We mentioned earlier the 12 and 24 volt systems. The basics is, if you remember way back, I used to have an early 1960s Volkswagen Bug. They had 6 volt batteries, but in the winter they won't start. Pablo knows that. 12 volt batteries are better because there's more oomph to it. But still, when they're cold or when they're old, they don't work as well. 24 volt systems, because you need less current, because you have more voltage, and power is a combination of voltage and current, all the components can be smaller and lighter, but get the same amount of workout. So I hope that helps, although I might have gone down a rabbit hole.
Now you know why we asked Jamie to be on this webinar, because he actually knows something, right? Yeah, that's wonderful.
I have cliff notes right here. I'm reading it.
All right, Chris, sorry.
All right, cool. So real quick, someone did ask, why does an alternator require electricity to work? It won't generate electricity just by itself?
That is coming up next. So that's a great question. How timely.
Great question.
Yeah. Way to go, Raz.
In fact, let me just throw a quick slide together for that question. And here it is.
Oh, you're so fast.
So one of the things was that you'll notice in the generator, we talk about having a fixed magnet spinning around a coil, inducing electricity. And of course, the problem is there that as you change RPM, it radically changes the voltage coming out. With an alternator, this, when I actually learned how this worked, I thought this was really cool. Notice on the bottom, we have that same coil for creating the electricity and sort of the system. But on the top, rather than having a magnet that spins around it, we take another coil of wire and we create an electromagnet. So the cool thing is, if you could take a magnet and move it across a coil and make electricity, or you could run electricity through a coil and get a magnet. And so in this case, what we do is we have this electromagnet that acts as our magnet. And the cool thing about it is that taking power from the battery and then regulating or figuring out like how much power we need to change the strength of that magnet, we can vary the strength of that magnet, which then changes how much electricity we're creating. And so the idea here being that as you're changing RPM, like for example, as you go low RPM, you'd make that electromagnet stronger, making more electricity. Or as you increase RPM, you would lower the strength or lower the electricity going to the electromagnet, so you make less electricity. So it does a better job of evening out how much power is coming out of the alternator. But yeah, do note for that question the person just asked, that the battery is what's providing the power to that electromagnet. So no battery, no electromagnet, no power for your alternator.
It's also worth throwing in, just so people are aware, a generator is a DC device, direct current. An alternator is an AC device. AC devices don't have as much line loss, so it's a more stable signal.
Very cool. And so just in right there, and the other thing too with the alternator control unit, what it does as well is, of course, it senses how much power you're using in your system, and then that adjusts how much power it thinks, you know, it decides the alternator needs to keep the system running and, of course, to recharge the battery. So it is kind of weird that you need the battery to run the alternator, but then the alternator is actually charging the battery back up.
Oh, that's kind of confusing, isn't it?
It is. It's kind of weird. And I used to always think, too, like, well, why wouldn't the alternator, once you get it started, just feed itself with electricity? But it doesn't work that way. Is there any good reason for that, Jamie? Or is that just something?
Because perpetual motion doesn't work.
I was going to say, I knew that answer. I knew that.
So you're good saying there's now. A chance.
Exactly.
All right. So we've got the idea here now. We've got the idea that most of the newer airplanes, and of course, when we say newer in aviation terms, we're talking like 1970s and beyond, you're likely going to see an alternator in that airplane. So we have an idea of how we're generating electricity or creating electricity to charge the battery. Let's take a look next at how we can monitor the system in a little bit more detail about those and what you might see in the airplane. And so here what we're getting at is, hopefully we've seen these before. I know we have the ammeter, which is showing in that left the left part of the picture there, which basically tells us whether or not the system is charging or discharging. And in fact, I know from our discussion earlier, one of the things to think about is if you pay attention during startup, you're using a lot of battery power to turn the starter, because that little starter motor is using just battery power to turn the entire engine over. And so you'll definitely see that ammeter go to a discharge. And then once you get the airplane started and kick the alternator on, you'll see that going to a charge. So it's good to know, to monitor that. And later I'll talk about too how I learned how to monitor. It was because I've had 3 electrical failures. And after that first one, that was really a key where I put that into my scan, whereas before that I didn't really pay attention to it. So it's funny how things like that happen.
All right, real quick. So someone says during their pre-flight, they check the ammeter by flipping the landing light switch. And sometimes the ammeter jumps down and they know that's good. Sometimes it doesn't move. I assume it's good.
Jamie?
That can be a variation in the ammeter itself. There's a resistor in there that kind of, it's what allows you to run the electricity through, and it tells you what amount you're using. But that resistor has a plus or minus 20% tolerance. So you could have 5 of the same unit, serial numbers right off the line, but each of those resistors is going to change. So one of them will show a significant movement, one will show almost none. But that does happen. You kind of need to get used to that particular ammeter, because they're going to have different size swing to illustrate the same condition.
And that's a great point, Jamie, too. That's one of the things that we'll bring up again later, is the idea of knowing what's normal for your airplane, and that way you can tell when things are abnormal or, you know, when things might be wrong. And then just to hit the other side of this picture here as well, let's talk about the load meter. I've mostly flown in Cessnas when it comes to instructing and things, but I do know that in the Pipers I've flown, you'll see a load meter. And the cool thing about that is the load meter will show you how much you're using. So in other words, if you turn the airplane on and are literally running nothing electrical, it'll show something around 0. And as you keep turning things on, like the landing light or operate the flaps and so on, you'll see that load meter increase. It's just showing the total load on the system.
I got a question about that, and Jamie, because he seems the guy that knows, you know, what he's talking about here. But
thanks, Keith.
Yeah. does it matter? I mean, do they both give you the same, you know, quality of information?
They give you the same basic information, but they're kind of telling you different things. The ammeter is telling you whether you're charging the battery or discharging the battery. It's telling you what the system is doing. The load meter, it won't go below 0. If you're not, as Chris says, if you're not using anything, you've just got the engine running with the mags powering it, it shows 0. It won't show a negative if you've got a discharge. But when you hit that avionics master switch, it'll spike up. And you turn on the landing light, it'll come up, and it tells you the total amount. Its real value is if you were to lose the alternator and you know how much battery power you've got and how much am I using, I could shed load. And I know you're going to talk about that later, Chris, but I could shed load and use that load meter to tell me what do I got to work with.
Oh, that's cool. That's a great point too, Jamie. So we'll come back to that idea again. We do talk about shedding load a little later on. That's awesome. All right. So here's
Real quick. So someone just said, so if different ammeters can have different swings, then what good are the numbers displayed on the face?
Well, you get used to what yours says. That's a standardized nomenclature on there, but yours will become, it's kind of like a fuel gauge. You know, you had that car where knew it would move 3/4 in the first quarter tank burn, but then the rest, same kind of thing. It's giving you an indication that's unique to it, and you get used to that one, and you can work with that.
So is that's okay, is what you're saying? Because I mean, I was flying one of our 172s, and it always indicates a discharge, and people squawked it over and over and over again. And I know that had been operating for the last year with that discharge with no problem. Is that okay?
It's not ideal. I had that once with an airplane where all of a sudden the ammeter went way into the negative side right after startup or during startup, and I was kind of freaked out about it. It turned out that when they had redone the airplane, they wired the ammeter backwards. So it was actually showing that I was charging after starting, but it was showing a discharge. So yeah, if it's not right, it's not right. But if you get used to your ammeter swings, say 5 amps negative during startup, and then it swings 2 positive, and then somebody else's goes 10 negative and 8 positive, you're both doing about the same thing, and it's okay. You're seeing a negative where you should see a negative and a positive where you should see a positive.
Okay, so cool. it sounds like overall, and that's the thing I find value in, is that trend of charging or not. And just as a side note, Keith, too, I know that airplane you're talking about, and apparently we found out that the one gauge was installed incorrectly. So let's be curious to see if it changes now that they fixed it.
Well, hey, so keep in mind, by the way, even an altimeter has a tolerance for IFR flight that's acceptable, plus or minus 75 feet. Nothing's perfect. We're in the ballpark, but you got to get used to your aircraft.
Hey, guys, real quick. So is there a certain process you guys would recommend for checking the ammeter? I mean, is it turning the lights on, turning it off? Is there, what's the best way to check that?
I know I'll be curious for Jamie's take on this, but I know for me, I check when I turn it on just to make sure that it shows charging, you know, that the alternator is working and things. What do you think, Jamie? You probably have a better idea than just that simple kind of
thing. I actually do it during startup, because when I'm starting up, it should go way negative because I'm drawing a lot of current off that battery. And as soon as it fires up and the alternator kicks in, it should go positive to replace that lost charge. I see that in the first 20 seconds and I'm good.
See, that's a tip I didn't pick up, was that idea of looking for the negative. I don't tend to do that. That's a good idea.
Yeah, so you actually look at that, Jamie?
I do.
That's excellent, because, you know, like the webinar after next, we're talking about scan, knowing where to look. And so, you know, maybe we'll incorporate that.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah. All right.
So let's look at our overall picture. I'm sure most of you folks remember looking at, whether it's in your POH or from the Pilot's Handbook of Aeronautical Knowledge, that huge electrical diagram. I kind of did a simplified version of it here. I noticed I took out the starter. I took out things like contactors. But just to give us the overview of how the electrical system works, you'll see here a lot of the parts that we just talked about. So we've got the battery over on the lower left with the master switch, which then turns on the battery power, allowing it to then, you know, let the electricity flow and charge or provide power to whatever we want to use. Up at the top, we see the alternator control unit and the alternator, which we now know is powering and the systems and also charging the battery. We're going to talk a little later about that, the low voltage indicator. We got our load meter and ammeter in there. And then the one thing new on this chart that we haven't talked about was just the idea of the buses. So the primary bus, which comes on when you flip on the master switch, which you can think of in terms of a power strip, that it has all the typical things like fuel quantity indicators and pitot heat and strobe lights and that sort of stuff. And then the avionics master switch, of course, which has its power over the avionics bus, which helps us isolate the more sensitive stuff like the radios and navigation equipment. So that we don't have spikes that hit those during startup or shutdown or just anytime we're resetting the alternator.
So why do we have separate buses? Because I've seen some aircraft that had like primary and essential, you know, a fairly large number of buses. What's the purpose of that?
Well, you can lose one. You can have a problem where, say, in this simple one, and it's true in most modern airplanes built since the 70s. You can either run off the main bus, which is powered by the alternator once the airplane is running, or if you have a failure and something's wrong, you could turn that off and run off the battery bus, which is a backup source of power. So you've got a little bit of redundancy built in.
Okay. So it's kind of that idea of the redundancy and then also the isolation of certain things when you're when you want to be able to isolate them.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, so like,
I'm sorry, go ahead, Keith.
Well, like in my basement over here, I have two different boxes of switch of panels, you know, of switches, circuit breakers or whatever. Is that like a bus?
Well, I like to think of a bus as the main street. And then there are side streets that go off that are smaller. So the main street carries a lot of traffic, a lot of electricity. And off the side streets go the fuel gauges and the turn coordinator and the lighting and all that. So we have circuit breakers where we can take any one of those little streets out, but we have the master switch that can take the bus out.
All right, great.
Very cool. And then of course, not to mention even the switches that are on the potential pieces of equipment. And we'll talk about some of that when we get to the shedding load idea. All right, let's go to our next poll. So if you'd roll that poll, Stephen, would hand propping an airplane with a dead battery cause the battery to recharge? We've already kind of given a hint at this one earlier, but what do you guys think? And one of the things we could start to talk about, of course, our choices here are definitely it's fail-proof. Maybe it's tricky. Definitely seems a little dangerous, or my favorite, I fly gliders. So what do you think, Jamie? Any thoughts here as we're getting these folks to fill out the poll on hand propping? What do you think about hand propping just in general when it comes to like safety? Some of the things you mentioned earlier about when you're going to hand prop, what are some ideas to do it safely, or should you not do it?
And much like aerobatics, hand propping isn't something you want to teach yourself. You should actually learn to do it because it works. I mean, it's a time-tested process, but if you do it wrong, it can literally kill you.
Wow. There's a lot of people who aren't weighing in on this. Come on now. Don't hang back. We're not looking at individual names. Go ahead and put in a vote.
Well, I'll
not
tell you what.
You could pick
I've
the
seen
one
a certain video. I've seen a certain YouTube video of someone doing that in a Cirrus. And that's a perfect example as to why you should learn it the proper way before not even trying it.
Oh, wait a minute. Now, this is the second week Cirrus has come up, okay? We're not picking on Cirrus. This has nothing to do with Cirrus, the aircraft brand, okay? Right?
Let me ask you, the three, how many of you have ever hand-propped an airplane?
I haven't.
No.
Okay.
The closest I get is to try to burp the engine on the RV.
I used to own a Cub, and that was the way you do it, but... You know, you do have to learn how to do it. And there's nothing wrong with it. You can do it from the front, you can do it from the back, but you do have to know how to do it.
All right, Stephen, let's put the results up.
Let's see if I move that over. So it seems like a little dangerous, potentially. Not sure, it could be tricky. I like the 2% that said I fly gliders. It makes it really simple for this stuff.
I like the 52% that said definitely seems a little dangerous because it's good to have some trepidation.
Good. Smart pilots there.
Yeah.
Okay, Stephen, pull those results down. And Chris?
All right. So charging a dead battery. So the real thing we're getting at is, it's like when we gave that clue earlier, we said somebody even asked the question, if your battery is dead, will it recharge? Will the alternator work, I should say? So if your idea is my battery's dead, it won't start, and I want to hand prop the airplane to get it going, well, if that battery is truly dead, you have no alternator. It's just not going to work. And so that won't recharge it. But Jamie, can you tell us a little bit more about what are the dangers of just trying to do this in the first place, of trying to charge a battery, whether this method or even plugging it in while it's still in the cowling?
Well, if you're trying to use the engine in order to recharge the battery, you're using a small device to put out an enormous amount of power. You're asking the alternator or the generator to put out maximum effort for a long time, the entire flight. You're going to generate a lot of heat. There's all that vibration to deal with. You could absolutely burn out your generator and your voltage regulator, and you could even potentially start a fire. So, but whatever happens, you're not going to end up with a charged up battery. So while the airplane will start and fly because the mags run in the engine, that's completely separate from the electrical system. A dead battery should be recharged in a shop outside the airplane, not in the engine compartment.
And so the same thing, I've come across a few times giving flight reviews and things like that too. Sometimes I get folks that'll tell me, oh, you can use the ground power unit, the little side part where you can plug ground power in. Is that a good way to recharge the battery as well?
No, you really do. Because of the amount of power, because they off-gas hydrogen, because they heat up and you can have thermal runaway, although it's unlikely, you really do want the battery out of the airplane in a shop. You don't want to be doing that in the airplane for the same reason you don't fuel an airplane in the hangar. If something goes bad, you're stuck with it now. If the battery catches on fire, you can't pop the cowl and get it out of there. So, yeah, it's a bad thing.
Wait a second.
Awesome. So,
Wait, no fuel in hangar?
Pablo.
The second thing we've learned today, right?
Oh my God.
Thank you, Jamie.
So the big thing here, I think the big takeaway is no, bad idea. If you've got a dead battery, it's time to take that battery out, get it charged properly. Don't try doing it by hand propping it. Don't try doing it some other method. Get it out of the airplane and get it charged properly by a shop. All right.
Absolutely. And I should point out, if you got a tricycle gear airplane, hand propping is particularly dangerous because the physics are wrong. You're going to end up putting your head into the arc of the propeller, and those two things should never be in close proximity.
Very good. So the tail wheel a little safer. And notice in this picture too, it doesn't, I didn't notice it at first, but there is a pilot at the controls in this airplane while it's being hand propped. That's a kind of a key thing as well, I believe.
I think that might be the one that Pablo was talking about because he did successfully start the airplane. It did not stay where he wanted it to be.
It did not stay where he wanted to. No, it did not. Hey, so someone asked here about trickle chargers. I mean, I use one on my motorcycle. I actually never thought about using one on a plane. Is that a good idea during the winter months?
Yeah, some people do, and there's even solar powered ones that you just plug into the cigarette lighter and it does help keep the battery charged up because like any other device, if it just sits there static, it loses its oomph. So yeah, you can use those.
Cool. All kinds of stuff we didn't even plan on coming out today.
That's right.
All right, so let's talk a little bit now. We got an idea of how the system works. Let's talk about when stuff breaks. And so we're going to look at three different conditions. We're going to look at low voltage, over voltage, and then, of course, the worst being an electrical fire. So we'll talk about a low voltage here, and this is the one that I've had the most experience with. I've had three times. In fact, I had one day, the first time I had an electrical failure, I had a full electrical failure, and then I literally, the next flight after it that day, because I was instructing full time at the time, I had another electrical failure. And in both cases, well, the first time I didn't notice this, the next time I was paying attention, you're going to have the ammeter showing a discharge. And so that's why it's a good idea to monitor that. And we'll talk about that when we get to the practical part at the end. And then also, you'll likely have a warning light, the low voltage warning light that will come on in some fashion. So it's important, of course, to know where that is in your airplane and to keep it in your scan. When it comes to why would this happen? It could be several things. There's a nuisance trip where in the alternator control unit, you might have something where it sensed something and it just shut the alternator down because it thought there was a problem. And so, like a circuit breaker, there's a procedure to follow, and we'll talk about that briefly in the checklist of resetting that. It could be that a wire, which I've had happen to me before, comes disconnected from the alternator and it stops working. Maybe your battery is starting to fail. Jamie, any other things we could add on here for what might cause this to happen?
In all honesty, there's a lot of options. You could have something shorting and it's shunting electricity away from where it's supposed to go to someplace else. There's such diversity in aircraft systems, it's hard to say it would be this. You kind of have to look at each individual case.
So I guess the big thing then is it's like we can't necessarily diagnose it while we're flying, but at least having an idea of what might be. But then of course the big thing is follow your checklist. And in this case with a low voltage, most like I'm using the 172 as my example today, but most aircraft you're going to do something like shut down the system. And so follow the checklist. You're going to turn the avionics off. You're going to turn off the master. I know in this case you're going to try to reset the alternator control unit. So turn the master off. You're going to let it maybe sit for, and your checklist may or may not see this, but maybe let it sit for a minute or two, let things cool down, and then try restarting it. And then that alternator might come back online, but if it doesn't, now you're looking at the situation that we'll talk about in a little bit of starting to shed power and now we're flying on battery alone.
Well, I'm
Anything
sure
else you
you
would
can.
think to add? I'm
Well,
sorry.
actually, I was going to say this is one of those things that we don't necessarily think of overtly, but when we do our private pilot check ride, one of the things we have to do is divert. One of the reasons is this: something's happened and I don't really know what it is, but I have a problem. Maybe my original destination isn't where I'm going anymore. So when I shut that alternator off to reset the ACU, I might consider starting to think about where am I going.
Right.
Excuse me, but yeah, Chris, you said shut the master off, right?
Yes.
So I kind of noticed that most of the planes I have two sides of the master switch. Do you, mm-hmm. you flip both of them off, or just why does it have two sides? What's that all about?
So I can hit this, and I'm sure Jamie will pick up on it. But of course, you've got the one side is controlling the battery power coming on, and the other side being the alternator. Again, I'm using the 172 as an example just because I'm most familiar with it. And in that case, you're shutting the whole master off, so turning the battery and the alternator off. But I'll throw it to Jamie in the sense of, would there be any reason that you would only maybe turn one of those sides off, either the alternator or the battery, when resetting?
You might choose in a situation like that just to turn the alternator side off to reset the ACU and keep the battery on so you've got your radios, especially say you're in Class Bravo airspace. Mm-hmm. You can do that now and I didn't lose communications. But if you're in Echo airspace or Golf airspace and you don't have a problem, you might just shut off both because it's not going to affect the engine. Let it settle down, cool down, as you say, and then pop it on again. But just remember to turn the avionics master off so you don't spike everything.
So when you're turning the alternator sign on or off, if you chose to do it that way, is there any chance of getting that spike that could hurt the avionics when you bring that alternator back online?
No, you shouldn't. And okay. There's protection in most of those devices now. It's better than it used to be, but you should have a fairly stable supply. When you're on the battery side, if you have a real low voltage, you may have a drop in voltage. When you bring the alternator back, it may not come back up. And now you know, I'm just running off the battery. I got to find someplace to go.
Very cool.
All right. So real quick, we've had several of you. That's why I bring it up now. So I don't mean to go back in time here, but there's a lot of people saying that they have LED landing or taxi lights and they don't draw much of a load. So it's kind of hard to see if there's an ammeter change. So let's see, I started using the alternator switch to take the alternator offline briefly to see if the ammeter drops and red light illuminate. Is that okay or is there a better way? We've gotten 6, 7, 8 questions on LEDs.
It's actually two different questions. What Chris was talking about here is a voltage warning. You have a low voltage, which is different than your ammeter. You're still pulling the same amount of current because you've got those devices on, but the voltage is dropping, which is telling you you're no longer recharging the battery, even if you have enough voltage to run the systems. So I know it can be a little confusing, but a low voltage indication and a low amperage indication are different things.
Okay.
All right, cool.
Thank you.
And maybe to the point of the people that do have one, if they are trying to test the alternator using or the ammeter using the landing light, maybe use something else. Like if you have electric flaps, that will certainly use enough power to show a change on the ammeter. Of course, one thing you don't want to try to do is don't try using the gear to do that. So maybe something else, find something else that does take a little bit more load. And of course, like what Jamie says, I would think paying attention to the start would be a good way to see if it's working or not as well, because clearly the starter is going to draw some power, no doubt.
All right,
let's get to the overcharge condition here. We've got the indications here, the ammeter. What we'd see in this case, we've got an ammeter showing, like in this picture, something way beyond what normal charge would be. And I happen to have a picture. This actually happened to me, so 22.3. In this situation, it turns out that it was a faulty ammeter that was going on, but you could see an overcharge this way. You might see the electronics beginning to fail from too much power going in, or maybe even eventually smoke or fire. And causes here might be something like an open circuit where the alternator is just pumping out power because it thinks the battery's not charging or whatever. And in fact, I'll let Jamie kind of hit on these. Or it could be that your alternator control unit has failed and is just letting full power go through. So Jamie, you want to hit any of the other causes there that might happen? Or
yeah, you could have something like the negative post on the battery comes disconnected and the system thinks the battery is dead, so it starts charging at maximum. You know, that's not ideal because you're not going to charge up the battery. And that could be corrosion on a post or something like that. But you're matching out the system. And what that'll do is eventually lead to a failure of the alternator. Or as you said, you know, the enemy of electricity is heat and vibration. We have plenty of that in aircraft. But when you're producing that kind of amperage, you're heating things up, which is why the cable that runs from the battery to the starter is so big. And the ones that run to your radio are so small because of the amount of amperage they have to carry. If you're pumping out that much amperage, the possibility of starting a fire is very real.
Cool. So it's important to know, and I know that, and of course, check your manufacturer, check your POH, but in general, when this happens, the thing you're going to be doing, follow the checklist, of course, but the general theme is you're shutting down the alternator and you're now running on battery power, which leads us back to the idea of maybe it's time to divert. shedding load, which we'll talk about here at the in just a moment here. So that's the big thing.
Does would that have any bearing or any effect on avionics to flip on the on off the alternator switch? Will it spike the avionics? Is it bad in any way?
Right. So that's one we, I know we just answered. We just talked about that last time. So just to make sure that's clear, as Jamie mentioned, is that if you're turning the entire master switch off, then you want to make sure the avionics, which is part of the checklist, turn the avionics off so you're preventing that. But I know Jamie mentioned this just on that last slide. It's like now with the newer avionics, generally speaking, that if you're still keeping the battery on and just recycling the alternator, that shouldn't, as you mentioned, Jamie, there are protections in there that would keep it up, keep it from happening.
Newer avionics has better protection than the stuff from 15 years ago, and that little bit of a spike won't cause a problem.
Yeah. All right, let's go. Let's keep this moving because we have a couple more slides to do, and we want to make sure we get the questions on time. So this next one is just, you know, let's say that we let it go too far, or maybe, you know, we get something like a bare wire, a short circuit happening. We might smell a burning smell or smoke or fire happening in the cabin, and probably most likely caused by a bare wire or short circuit. And of course, in this situation, now we just want to shut the electrical system down, extinguish the fire until you follow your checklist. And on the 172, you end up closing the vents so you can cut off any air, extinguish it, and then sort of ventilate the cabin. And then the real question comes on this one to me is, do I restart the electrical system? Of course, that depends. If I'm in day VFR, I might just leave it all off and just fly back to my closest airport and get it down. If I'm in IFR, then maybe I need to turn some things back on. So I'm really going to be thinking, what are the absolute minimum things, and be very cautious about restarting anything. Any thoughts on that, Jamie?
Yeah, well, the secondary problem in an electrical fire is really the thing you're worried about most, because you can turn the master switch off and that deprives everything of power and the electrical fire should stop. But if it generated enough heat to start something else burning, something in the aircraft, now you've got a whole different problem. So yeah, restarting the electrical system, you almost want to, if you go that route, shut the master off, shut everything off manually. When you bring the master on, bring things back one at a time individually. Don't just pop on the master, the avionics master, and you get a whole suite of things. Now you don't know where the problem is.
And in fact, to add on to what you're saying, Jamie, too, is that this is an important thing that leads us into our next slide, which is when we want to start shedding load, is knowing how to turn off all those individual things. And in this case, I would want to individually turn off everything before I even tried to turn the master back on, just so that I don't inadvertently bring up things that I didn't want to turn on. So making sure I know how to turn all those individual units off.
So there's so many different avionics within the cockpit, and I don't want to get, how about this one? How about that one? How about the Avadyne? But specifically, I think probably a lot of airplanes have either 430s or 530s. Are those considered old, specifically the 530? So would those be in the older category that could be under duress?
I would say the 430 might be. I'm not sure about the 530. But, you know, it's always worth erring on the side of caution. So if there's any question in your mind, just assume the bad thing will happen and do whatever you'd have to do to prevent that.
Okay,
cool.
How about, right, lastly, sorry. This is one about the voltage again, because there's actually more than one. There's been a couple that have said that they don't even have a voltage indicator in their airplanes. So they were wondering, I didn't even know these existed, so call me stupid, but plug-in voltage indicators, like USB ones, or will those work?
Well, it's kind of like any handheld device. Yeah, there's things you can plug into the cigarette lighter. A lot of old planes don't have a voltmeter, but they have a cigarette lighter. It's going to tell you what the system is using. You can use things that, and again, that's like a handheld device. It's not an approved thing. It's not panel mounted. I don't know if your airplane didn't come with a voltmeter, maybe you're comfortable with that. And as I said, I had a Cub, didn't have anything. So if you've got an ammeter, that's giving you an indication of the health of the system. It depends how much you need, and you could probably get an STC to put a voltmeter in if you really want one.
Might be worth having one of those too.
So then say you don't have an ammeter or voltmeter, and you don't have one of the plug-in devices. What's your first indication, short of everything going dark, that is there any indication?
You mean if you've got no voltmeter, no ammeter, and you're going to notice the radio is getting weaker?
Yep.
Okay.
Some of your lighting might noticeably get dimmer, but that's about it.
Yeah, that's what I was, my experience too. I told you that first time I had it where I was a brand new instructor and I was too busy instructing and I wasn't keeping the electrical system in my scan. And the way that I noticed was the radios, the lights on the radio started getting dim, especially when pushing transmit. And I remember even saying to my student, man, the radios sound funny, don't they? And the next time we transmitted, the entire thing went dead. So it was, that's to me the things that I noticed first as I really watched those displays and see if they're acting weird.
Yeah, you mentioned this the other day, and I think it's an important thing to notice. It uses very little power to monitor the radio, uses a lot to transmit. And you'll start noticing that as you're transmitting, you'll start hearing it sounds funny. And gee, I usually can get the power from here, and now you can't.
In fact, that leads us to our next slide, which is when it breaks, how do we shed load, this idea of shedding load? And some of the things to know, which we'll talk about here in a moment, is like knowing the amp hour rating of your battery. And I'll let Jamie talk about that here in a moment. But the big thing is we want to know what are the big things that are draining power and how do we tell? And so things like radios, your transponder, anything that's sending out a signal is going to likely be using more power. Do you have a glass panel display? Do I need to keep that up or can I fly without it? Do you have a backup battery for that? And then the big thing, the theme that we may hit some details here, but the big thing, the theme here is to know what's drawing power. Is easiest thing is look at your circuit breaker panel because all those numbers on those circuit breakers are telling you how much they're drawing. And in the airplane flying handbook, there was a little table here. So you might look in your, look in the information for your airplane and see if you could find something like this where it tells you, how much power the different pieces of equipment pull. So Jamie, did you want to maybe just talk briefly about the idea of the amp hour rating of the battery and the usefulness of that, and then the idea of a backup battery for the glass panel?
Well, just say for round numbers, say you have a 60 amp hour battery. It means it can provide 1 amp for 60 hours or 60 amps for 1 hour, and whatever balances out there. So you actually have, when your alternator fails, when your system's going bad, you have power for a time with the battery, but by knowing what you're drawing, as you said, you can get an idea of how long am I gonna have this. Let's say you used to fly in Arizona. Let's say I'm 40 minutes away from an airport and I'm running on my battery. I don't want to trust it for that long. So I'm going to shut everything off and I'll get by with really just looking out the window until I get to where, okay, I'm going to power on just the radio or just the transponder, whatever I need so that I can be safe in the environment. But Pablo had brought up before, people who have LED lights. Well, those draw a lot less power. So that's true. But do you actually need them? Or is it a clear daytime and I can shed that power too? So it's a decision you have to make. And one of them that we probably should talk about, Chris, is if I've got an electrical gear extension system, am I going to have enough power left to do that? Or should I plan on doing the emergency gear extension? If I've got electric flaps, maybe I plan on a no-flap landing because I may or may not have enough power to extend them.
And that really leads into this idea too. If you decide that, if I'm flying day VFR again, and hopefully, you've really gotten the idea down of looking out the window, this little piece of wisdom, which I will have to give credit to Jamie for coming up with this one, which is for VFR flying, the only instrument you really need is a windshield. So maybe if you're not comfortable flying that way, that would be a good thing to practice, is to go up with a CFI, cover up your glass panel, and just try flying just looking outside, because it actually does make flying way easier anyway. But also prepares you just in case something like this were to happen.
Absolutely.
So let's go ahead, and what we're gonna do is let's get to our last slide here before we go to questions, which is how do we take the practical application for everything that we've just talked about? And the thing that I wanted to get out here was that this is something I learned the hard way. Because I told you, I was a brand new CFI. I hadn't really, like as a private pilot, commercial pilot, as I was doing all my training, this hadn't really come into play until I had, while instructing, that full electrical failure, which is how to keep the gauges in your scan. And I know it's something we're gonna talk in more detail about later, but I just showed here, this is a 172 cockpit. And my flow that I use for the 172 starts down at the fuel selector, which is just off the bottom of the picture. It comes up along the trim, then I'll check the flaps, where the indication is, where that is, the mixture and throttle, work my way across the circuit breakers over to where the primer and the ignition are in this case, and just work my way up to are the switches and the lights where I want them to be. Then I look at my instruments, like sort of the flight instruments, and then come down looking and monitoring my engine instruments and then the avionics. And I do this every time I get a moment. So I definitely one thing I teach and I really do believe in is if you're finding yourself kind of chilling in the airplane, just sort of relaxed and not doing anything, I'm in the mindset of I'm missing something. And so I do this flow again. I'm always monitoring. And of course, it's because of having all the electric. I've had three electrical failures in the airplane while flying. And so that has really driven home the point of you've got to pay attention to stuff, because by seeing it early, now I get options. I can catch it early. And it's also important in this case to me to know the limits. So for example, Jamie mentioned early on having a 28 volt system. That's good to know, because when I'm watching the ammeter and it has the voltage or the voltmeter actually that some of them will have, like combined with the ammeter, it's good to know like, oh, that thing should be right around 28 volts. Like I know on our airplanes, right around 27.5, 27.8 is pretty normal. If it goes below that, I know something's wrong right away. And so now I can start taking care of it early and I've got more battery power rather than less.
Hey, Chris.
And then yes.
You said you had three electrical failures, right?
Yes.
And so, but it takes a spark to make the cylinders fire, right? So
yes.
What, did your engines not stop? I mean, what happened?
I know, why? It's crazy, right? But of course, hopefully we all remember from doing our training that the magnetos are a totally separate source. And in fact, they're just little generators. They use magnets within them and power the spark plugs. So the engine is completely separate. And one of the things that I really recommend that I like to do, because of the things that have happened to me, and I've had students in the past that I was working with that were worried about this kind of stuff, that you know, if you turn off the master switch, that the engine would stop. So one of the things I do is I will go up and while in flight, while we're doing the emergency procedure section, at least one time, we actually will shut the master switch off, shut everything off while we're flying, and it just drives home that point. So if that's something you worry about, go out with a CFI and do it, because you'll see that the thing still runs. It runs just fine without the master switch being on.
Great. All right.
And then anything else you guys want to add, Jamie, or anything? Anything I'm missing?
I will go out there. I also had a complete electrical failure once coming out of Key West. The plane started, I made radio calls, everything was fine. I got about 4 miles from the airport and I had nothing. I couldn't get anybody on the radio, realized the flaps didn't work anymore. So it really has been worth being prepared for this beforehand by understanding what your options are, because the airplane in flight is a lousy place to try and figure out, gee, I wonder what I could do. It's best to know your options and then just make a decision and go with it.
And maybe you guys, just the last point here before we go to our question section. For me, I know I've had a couple of times, whether the emergency things or the electrical failures that I've had. I had another time where I had I was flying freight before, and I had both my engine fire lights come on at once. It turns out they weren't both on fire, oddly enough. But when that happened, the big thing I'll tell you is it is really important, and I can't recommend enough, especially now that we've got time that maybe we're not flying, review your emergency procedures and make it a regular practice, because when it actually happens, I know at least for me, it was scary. There's that couple seconds of panic, like, oh my gosh, what am I gonna do? And the one thing I can tell you is because I would drill those things, then that took over. And maybe, I know Keith, you flew in the Navy. I know Jamie, you've done a ton of flying, maybe Pablo too. Any of you guys have any thoughts on that, of that idea of procedures, when things go bad, how procedures can help?
Well, actually I'll say that the thing you just said about there's a moment of panic or indecision or whatever, you know, being pilots, we try to be steely cool guys who never have a problem, but I've had two engine failures in my career, and wow, there is that very short moment where like, no, this is not happening to me. You're just in denial. You have to revert very quickly to what's the appropriate solution to this, or what am I going to do? Because there, in those situations, there's not time to pull out the book. You're going to have to just do it from memory.
All right, boys, I think it's time for us to go to questions. Have we gotten any questions at all, Pablo? A single one?
Well, you know, let me check my notes. Well, there's one right there. So let me ask that if you guys are ready.
Sure.
Yeah.
All right. So during an idle check when doing your pre-takeoff run-up, what would the ammeter be indicating in general aviation systems, say a 172 or Warrior? That's a tough, that's generic, but that's, you know, I'm just trying to go with
an older 172 that has a generator, a late 50s, early 60s 172 at idle, it's going to be showing a discharge. And a newer one, say a 77 or newer, at idle, it's going to be showing very near zero, where it's even. It's got a slight charge, but not a lot.
Okay, thank you. So pros and cons of a 12 or 24 versus a 24 volt system.
In my experience, 12 volt batteries tend to be cheaper than 24 volt batteries. 24 volt systems are better. The components can be lighter, and obviously weight is a big deal in aviation. And if you live in a cold weather environment, a 24 volt battery will get you started where 12 volt just wouldn't have done it.
Okay.
But you wouldn't know anything about those cold weather environments, would you, Jamie?
It's true.
I avoid those northern places. I don't like to be any farther north than Disney World.
Did Jamie mention that he's based in Florida?
Yeah.
And that it's 77 and breezy down there right now. Ridiculous.
Yeah. What else do we have, Pablo?
Well, we have to look in Chicago. We have to look for a place to plug in our plane. So that's
yeah.
Fine.
There you go.
Did you bring the long enough extension cord? All right. Why would an alternator drop off during flight, but then back online when the engine was next started?
You could have a bad voltage regulator. It could be sticking. The ACU could be a problem. You know, there are other pieces in there where it's not that the alternator is not working. It's the signal it's getting about what it needs to feed the system is wrong. So that's one where you'd want a mechanic to go diagnose the problem. And I should say, intermittent electrical problems are very difficult to diagnose because they come and go.
All right, so
hey, can I just take a quick pause here? I just wanted to mention, because I know we're coming to the end of the hour, next week we've got practical practices, weather, and the long VFR cross country coming up. So if you're interested in that, but I know that we're going to stick around answering questions for as long as the folks want to ask them. So I just wanted to just throw that out there just in case anybody decided they wanted to drop off at the end of the hour.
Okay, thank you, Chris.
Pablo is going to be the lead on this on our next webinar, and we are just looking forward to your font of aviation knowledge, right?
I mean, and that's exactly what it is. It's beautiful. So here's another one. Are sealed batteries worth the extra expense?
You know, I think they are. The old-fashioned lead-acid battery where there's a liquid acid in there, they can leak. And when they do leak, and you'll see this sometimes in an older plane that you're doing a pre-buy inspection on, it can do an enormous amount of damage in the engine compartment or under the back seat or wherever it is. I like the sealed batteries very much. And, you know, it's an advance. It's kind of like the generator going to the alternator. It's a better product.
Okay. So what would you recommend for replacing a battery? How often?
When it's needed only. They're expensive, so I wouldn't replace it if, you know, just because a new one came out. Ooh, that one's got a nice label. No.
All right. So you guys talked about electrical fires. What's the best fire extinguisher and the best practice of actually using one in the cockpit?
Ooh. I'm going to defer to Chris on this because fire extinguishers in the cockpit can be very dangerous. You know, You use a halon fire extinguisher in the cockpit, you created a whole new problem. So,
yeah, I don't know that I have a really better answer necessarily for that because fortunately I've never had to deal with it. I know the basic idea, and Jamie backed me up on this, is that you're shutting everything down, and if you know that there's smoke or whatever coming, you're probably going to get it up behind the panel there and try to extinguish whatever's going on, and then of course ventilate. So that's something that I'd have to do some more research on.
One of the things we talk about here in Florida, because there's so much water, if you have a fire in the airplane, I don't mean just an electrical fire, but a fire where there's flames, we're landing right here, right now. If it's in the water or if it's in a swamp, whatever, that's a secondary problem. You don't want to be trying to cruise along to the airport when you burn through a spar. So
right.
We got to get it down.
Get it down, exactly, right.
All right, so real quick, I'm just going to make a quick announcement. It's 11:59. And I get this, and all of the ones we've done, I get this a lot towards the middle and the end. People have to leave or they got cut off or whatever. Everyone wants to know if they can watch this later, as you can imagine, right? Of course. So you will get an email, and if I'm wrong, Stephen or Keith, you will get an email after this is over with a link to the recording.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Yes.
And it's not immediate, because these are long and GoToWebinar has to do something. So there's a process and it has to upload it and create it and do stuff to it. So it probably takes about an hour or so.
Several hours, maybe I think 3 hours.
Okay, and so there will be a link to it, and then you can watch us again. And I'd say watch as many times as we can, because stats matter.
I would. Okay. And would you say it's Chicago style? Watch it early and often.
Well, I would say I know who you are. Is all I gotta say. I got names here for all you guys that are writing here. Yeah, I got names. All right. So, all right, let's get back to the show. Is it better to turn the alternator on before or after the engine start?
After. Well, let me take that back. You don't need the alternator to start the engine. You need the battery to start the engine. But the reason that the alternator and the battery switch are combined is because the moment the engine starts, the alternator starts working. So in a technical sense, you are turning on the alternator after the battery and the engine start. The engine's got to be running for the alternator to work.
Right.
But you don't have to monitor the switch and manually change it. You can turn on both sides.
Let me ask or throw one thought out there, Jamie, too, with that, because I used to fly, I used to work at a school out in Arizona that we had a lot of 172s. We must have had 30 of them. And so one of the things that we did is we altered the basic checklist, because I know the normal 172 checklist just says turn the master switch on while you're, you know, of course, to get the battery running and all that. But we used to just turn the battery side on, and then we could, after we got it started, then we would turn the alternator on only for the reason we could then see if it was working. So we would then focus on the ammeter. Is there anything bad about doing that, or does that seem like a decent practice?
No, I look at it as there's procedure and there's style. So whether you flip the batteries and alternator on together or you do them separately, like you just described, you're doing the same thing. It's just you're more conscious of the state of the system, the way you're talking about.
Right.
That's a style thing. So procedure and style, I'm good with it. It's kind of like when you beam the numbers, there's a power reduction. What your power reduction is, that's up to you, but right, there's a power reduction.
Cool. So I think the only other thing would be, and someone did point it out here before I got to it, which is if you do the separate turn-ons, remember to turn it on.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
that's a possible downside of not doing it at the same time. So,
well, and you know, we tend to lean a lot when we taxi around because air-cooled engines, they use extra fuel as coolant and you follow your plugs. If you ever get out to the hold short line and forget to enrich, boy, you'll notice that you try and accelerate. It's a mess. So yeah, if you're going to do something unusual, make sure you follow the checklist and complete it.
Right. Yeah, that's the biggest thing. What I was talking about, we had a checklist that was part of our procedure that became a habit. So I guess it's about building those habits and having that backup with the checklist.
Mm-hmm. All right. So you guys said if voltage is low, it means the battery's not charging. What does low amperage mean?
Well, could mean you're not requiring much amperage. You know, low is a relative term. So the amperage is doing the work. So if we're thinking about the load meter and it's only showing 5 amps is being pulled, well, maybe all you've got on is a radio. So that's all it needs. If you've got low amperage because you're trying to use, you know, you're trying to drop the gear and use the flaps and you're still showing low amperage, that does suggest there's a problem with your electrical system that needs somebody to look at it. And let me go out there and say that knowing your system as a pilot is a good idea. And understanding what's normal working and what's a problem, it's worthwhile. You don't want to try and be a mechanic in the airplane while you're flying. I'm an AMP and a CFI. I don't try to fix the airplane while I'm flying it. I'll land and we'll pull out a toolbox and we'll mess with it. But you can create a huge distraction and all kinds of new problems by trying to diagnose a problem rather than just accept I have a problem. Am I going to my destination or am I landing early?
Right.
But don't get overly involved.
There's some sort of famous crash on an airliner.
The Northwest one, yeah. They had a bad jackscrew. And not to fault those guys at all. They were trying to diagnose the problem and kept working the system and eventually broke it entirely and that airplane crashed. Sometimes just accepting, okay, this isn't right. Is it not right enough that we need to land, or is it just a problem that I can work with? You know, sometimes you can get by just turning off a device and saying, I don't need that. Mm-hmm. But other times it's like our electrical failures. I had just left Key West. Now, do I want to fly for 4.5 hours with no electrical system and the sun setting? Or do I want to accept I have a problem and go back to the international airport, call somebody and get this fixed?
And I want to throw in there, too, that one of the electrical failures that I had was actually on a long trip with a former colleague of ours, Les Smith, and we had just taken off out of Charleston, West Virginia, in a 172. And as we're climbing out, because of the scan, I noticed very quickly that, hey, the alternator's not working correctly. And so then we had to make a choice because we were about halfway between going back to Charleston and to another airport that was up ahead. And so Charleston's a class C and the other one ahead was a class Delta. And so when making that call, we decided to go back to the class Charlie. And I asked, I mean, it was my colleague then, Les, at the time, I was like, well, why did you, what was your big thing that wanted you to make to go there? He said, because they're more likely to have rental cars, so, and a repair station. So that's a good thing too, is think also if you have the option, depending on the situation, we were in day VFR, but maybe it's like, what's going to be available when I get there too, to get this thing fixed and for us to be able to get home.
Mm-hmm. Cool. All right. This is kind of general. I don't even know if you can answer, but do you know if there's an average lifespan of a battery?
It depends where you are. I mean, geographically, your battery life, Pablo, in Chicago is not going to be what mine is in Florida, unless I stick mine in a hangar that's in direct sunlight with, you know, heat radiating down. It depends on the circumstance. Cold is going to beat them up fast. Heat's going to beat them up fast too, and it's not an aviation thing. That's why Tesla's batteries are liquid cooled, because it can maintain a stable temperature on those.
Okay. Here's a good one. Is it okay to jumpstart your airplane, your 12 volt airplane, with your car?
You can, and there's nothing unsafe electrically about that. But there is potentially something physically unsafe, because you're going to end up with a whirling propeller and the battery compartment may be very near that. So I'm going to say you can do that in an electrical sense. It's probably best if you don't.
And I'm wondering, what are we thinking there? Is it just because it's cold and we're trying to help the battery start, or is it because we have a dead battery, which we kind of talked about already? If it's a dead battery that's the problem, then that's probably not the best thing to do.
Okay. Just a couple more here. So earlier, way early, you guys were talking about starting procedures and external stuff and charging your battery and stuff like that. So someone says, so why does Cessna have an external power start procedure?
Well, you can be in a situation where you're in a cold weather environment and you just don't have enough power in the battery. You know, the oil turned to pudding because I'm in Minneapolis for the weekend and mm-hmm. I need something extra. But that external power thing is really, in most cases, it's so that you can run the avionics while it's in a shop system, or if we're at a show and we have the airplane lit up, that's what that's for. Having the procedure doesn't mean it's something you should do on a regular basis, and there are potential problems you cause with that. So
okay, whenever I fly at night, I'll tell you what, I wouldn't be flying at night much with this question here. Whenever I fly at night, I notice my lights flick when I have many lights on. Is there anything to be concerned about?
It could very well be that your alternator doesn't have the capacity to feed what you're drawing, and it's struggling to keep up. And if you went to LED lights, maybe that would help. But there's a reason that people upgrade the original alternator in a 1972 airplane, because the load we have now with all the avionics we've got in there is much more than it was when we had the totally analog system with one radio and one transponder.
All right, so someone says, we talked about ammeters and all this other stuff. So I don't know if we said, this person says, you said they're not accurate. I don't think we said that, but
there's a tolerance to them, and they can be less than precise.
Yeah, well, and so they said, so are there any good ones out there, or should I have just a false sense of security? Go with the false sense of security and call it a day.
Okay.
Be happy, right?
Exactly. Everything's got a tolerance. And as I said, you know, even for IFR flight, an altimeter has a tolerance, plus or minus 75 feet. Everything in the airplane has a tolerance. It's not exact. So that includes every component in the electrical system has a tolerance of their own, you know, plus or minus 20%, plus or minus 5%, plus or minus 1%. Depends how much you want to spend on those things. So you're never going to get perfect. So understanding the basic operation, as Chris is talking about, is the thing you're looking for. When should I have a positive indication? When should I have a negative indication? And when is that positive or negative excessive?
Right.
Knowing what that looks like in your airplane is what's going to keep you on the sunny side.
And even in that sense, knowing the numbers and pay attention to the numbers that you're seeing. If you've got a digital gauge or a voltmeter, pay attention to what those numbers are and know what's out of limits. So that's a key thing to help you monitor it.
And that's not just electrical. I've had three 152s in my job as ambassador. The oil pressure on each of them is different. The one I have now, it reads way up the top of the scale. The last one I had read way down the bottom of the scale, but they were within the scale. So it's, you know, they're just individual aircraft.
Okay. When an alternator fails, how long can you run the engine with magnetos only?
Until you run out of gas.
Exactly. Or until you shut the mags off. They will keep going because they're cool in that sense of that magnet. They're like that generator we talked about. They will just keep making electricity.
Well, remember though, CNN broke that story after the Malaysian flight that the 777 won't maintain altitude once you shut the engines off. So same thing with the mags and the fuel. There's a connection between those two.
Who knew?
Well, you know, interesting fact, I was delayed. I travel a lot, so I'm in Chicago, work in Frederick. And on one of my flights, we were heavily delayed and it was windy out. The two were completely non-related. But the woman in front of me did let me know that we couldn't take off because those big planes can't do more than a 15 mile an hour crosswind. Hmm. Good to know, everybody. I looked at her.
Were you flying in a large 172 or what?
I gave her my dog's. Okay, you're right. Let's move on. Okay, so someone says, my AMP recently replaced the alternator with a much newer one. Now my ammeter always shows a much lower draw just above zero. Is this to be expected or should I watch it? I think this probably goes back to everything.
Ammeter.
Recently replaced the alternator with a much newer one, my ammeter.
Ammeter should change throughout the operation, depending on are you starting or is it recharging the battery? Do you turn on devices? So it shouldn't be a fixed indication.
Okay.
So do you think in that case that maybe something to get looked at, Jamie, the fact that the new alternator, same ammeter, but new alternator is not showing as much charge? Is there something to check there?
I talk with a mechanic who put the alternator in and just find out, what can you tell me about this? I'm seeing a different outcome now. Why is that?
Right.
Okay. All right. So this is maybe a comment, maybe if you guys have a response to it, but someone says that when we were talking earlier about how to test the draw, someone says that the pitot tube also is good for testing the ammeter.
The pitot heat can be. Yeah. But yep. I live in Florida. We don't think about pitot heat.
Well, maybe to cook hot dogs.
That's right. All right, so someone also says, they're asking, is it recommended or would you recommend to try or test the charge by operating the electronic flaps?
I would think that's a good one because it's momentary, but that's definitely a big draw for those motors.
It sure is.
Or motor, depending.
Okay, this one, bear with me, it's a little longer, but it's also a situation where I think it's a good question in the sense of it makes you think for a moment. So after doing a touch and go, my CFI and I could no longer hear each other, nor could the tower hear us, but we could hear them. They could hear our mic click, just no voices. No fuses popped. Tried both comms, shut off, turned back avionics master, unplugged, plugged in headsets, didn't fix it. We could still hear everyone. They couldn't hear us. What possibly could have gone wrong in this situation?
A lot of things, to tell you the truth. There could be a connection, the continuity of a connection to the antenna where you can receive but you can't transmit. It could be power within the unit because the transmit function and the receive function are two different things. They're just in the same box. And it also could be the intercom since they couldn't hear each other. There's a lot of different things involved there. That's something you'd want to go to an avionics shop. If something is wrong, but you want to find it.
Yeah. All right, so I think we'll do two more. We're getting to that 15 past our hour. So in a vintage plane, is it wise to replace the generator with an alternator?
You know, if it was my plane, I probably would. Alternators have great advantage over generators. They're lighter, they're more efficient, they're more stable, they work better, and not having those peaks and valleys of voltage means anything it's connected to is going to work a little better and last a little longer. So it may be costly in some cases, but yeah, if there's an STC, if you can do it for that airplane, I probably would.
Okay. And then wait, I lost it. Oh, there it is. Shoot. This one I didn't write down because it was pretty recent. Now I can't find it. Anyway, okay. So here's another one though. Why do AC gauges lie and DC gauges die when this type of gauge fails?
Y'all laughed at me because I told y'all that the other day, right? You said, is that a Navy thing?
This guy was in the Navy too?
He might have been. We'll find out, I guess. Well,
so I think the big point maybe, and maybe correct me if I'm wrong there, Keith, but I know the big thing there is that one thing we did forget to mention in talking about that shedding the load or when you're shutting the battery off is to pay attention when you do turn the master off, look at what gauges no longer work, even while the engine's running. Because for example, it might freak you out that the fuel gauges are off on electric. So when you turn the master off, even though you've got plenty of fuel, they'll go right to zero. And look at some of your engine instruments too and see what turns off when you turn off the master. And so you're ready for that. So is that kind of what you guys were talking about in the Navy too?
I don't know. I don't know why, but we had some instruments that were AC and others that were DC. And so if you lose all power, if it's an AC gauge, it's going to stick where it was. Okay. If it's a DC gauge, it's going to go to zero.
Well, and you were flying turbines though. And in a turbine, generally you have a generator because it works as the starter and then it becomes a generator and you're rectifying that DC into AC. So that you can use it. So it's a separate shunt off, but that may be part of the, and I don't know. I've never worked on a Navy airplane because I'm a ground pounder.
All right. Well, it seems like that was our final question. So we're going to wrap it up.
Can I do one more?
Okay. Go ahead. Go ahead.
One more. Okay. So somebody says, I have a wing strobe that doesn't always flash when first turned on, but after running the plane, it comes on. And every time I have a mechanic look at it, there's nothing wrong.
I feel like this is car talk, Jamie. What do you think?
They've got a strobe that doesn't work initially, then does.
Yeah.
Yep.
If I'm not mistaken, there's going to be a small transformer in that strobe, and it may be just that, you know, it creates a field and collapses, which induces a higher voltage to run the strobe, and there may be a connectivity or it may be a bad transformer, but there's nothing physically wrong. It does conduct power, but I couldn't diagnose it for 100% accuracy from here. I'd need to be there.
Well, you know, guys, what surprises me about these questions is the number of aircraft ownership type questions, because we were debating whether we should have a show that was just about people owning aircraft. And I think from the number of questions here that, you know, there's a lot of interest out there. And so I think that we can probably see that in our future lineup. What do you think?
I think so, too. I agree.
I'd vote for that. Aircraft ownership is such a different experience than renting. And most people who own an airplane have owned one, maybe two. So having that insight would be really helpful.
Well, Jamie, we really appreciate you having you here. I mean, it's great to have somebody who knows what they're talking about. And so, you know,
finally,
what a refreshing change, right?
I had fun. Thanks so much, guys. I'm sorry we're all so far apart, but it's always a pleasure to work with you.
Yeah, and Chris, you did a great job of putting this together. I learned so much in your presentation. Yeah, good job. Good job.
Absolutely.
And thank you all for joining us. And we really hope to have you next week and in our future Don't Get Rusted, because we enjoy, you know, doing the show and we hope that you get something out of it. And so we look forward to seeing you in the future and have a great day. Fly safe.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, everybody.
See you next week. Yeah.